In Britain today, what were once luxuries are fast becoming everyday items.
I don't think of them as being luxuries, they're more my essentials.
From our electrical gadgets to our leather shoes, as we consume more and more, these products become increasingly disposable.
I buy shoes every 3 weeks, and what happens with the old shoes? I throw them away.
But would we care more if we knew the human cost of making our luxuries?
I never feel guilty at all about spending as much money as I do. You know, I've earned this money, so therefore it's my right to spend it.
7 young British consumers are travelling to Africa and Asia to live and work alongside third world workers.
Oh no, that is too heavy.
The people who mine.
It's just relentless. You're just going up and down and up and down.
Manufacture and recycle our luxury goods.
They can't walk away from this. If they walked out, then what are they going to do? Starve to death?
They are high-flying student Alexandria, part-time model and high-end shop worker Oscar, Sussex lad James, gold lover George, Geordie lass Sam, high-end luxury lover Lucy, and coffee addict Siobhan. Tonight, the Brits are in Ghana to discover how we get gold for the rings, necklaces, and earrings we buy on our high streets.
Well, this is the highest I've ever been in my life.
Genuinely, I'm about to collapse.
Shocked by the sacrifices the workers make.
We don't enjoy life.
The Brits not only question the industry.
20-odd people grafting for that.
No luxury can be worth this. This is pathetic.
But each other.
You can't shout it, we're all finding it hard, okay?
And find out that Africa isn't only where many of our luxuries start out.
It's burning plastic. That's not going to be toxic.
But often where they end up.
I'm disgusted. I actually feel like I want to turn and walk out.
Where do you sleep?
Yeah. It shouldn't be happening. We shouldn't let this happen. And yet it is.
Accra, Ghana. These 7 young Brits are about to experience a side of the gold industry we never see.
Considering I wear my jewellery every day, I should know where it's from.
In just a few hours' time, they'll start work in a mine, processing the gold sold on Britain's high streets.
I'm excited about going to this mine. I do love my gold. I've got 3 pieces of gold in my face right now.
First, they must travel 175 miles to the remote gold mining region of Takwa.
Seeing the sea and the palm trees and the sun, it's just like I couldn't possibly imagine, you know, anyone having a hard time here in the mine.
The Brits will be working in the isolated mining village of Badakrum.
Oh my God, this is where we're staying. Oh my God.
Ghana is Africa's 2nd largest producer of gold. It's been trading the precious metal since the 15th century and now exports around £400 million worth a year. Much comes from hundreds of small-scale mining communities like this. Here, only mining offers the villagers a regular wage.
Hello.
Hello, you are
I'm
welcome.
I'm Alex, nice to meet you.
I'm Sully.
Good.
Hello,
man, I'm
George.
Mine boss and co-owner Sully organises the workforce. The Brits are taken straight to where they'll be working for the next 2 days.
Wow. It looks like something from Flintstones. Look,
God, you're right, it does.
It does, doesn't it? It looks like it's not real. It looks like it's just been placed here.
There's no safety, there's no barriers or anything. Anyone could just fall.
The precious metal is dug out from gold-rich seams. The men shovel by hand, whilst the women carry 20-kilogram headpans to the top. Here, every load is counted before the process of extracting grains of gold from the mud begins.
Oh my God. Women are working with like babies on their backs.
Yeah. And pregnant. Just standing in shock.
The locals have to be strong. Abdullah, who owns the one-acre mine with his brother Sully, will expect the same from the Brits.
For
us, in this heat, that many buckets back and forth 100 times.
I think it's going to be a hard one.
Like the locals, the Brits will be split.
I think it is going to be hard work.
The boys are working at the bottom of the mine with the men, digging up the gold-rich earth to fill the headpans.
The problem at the moment is like the heat, sweating because it's so hot. This is the hottest I've ever been in my life.
Alongside the local women, the girls must carry their 100 headpans to the top of the mine, ready for processing.
Oh my God, this is heavy. Oh my God, this is so heavy.
Oh my God.
I can't even lift it, so there's no point filling it up.
Right from the start, the Brits are struggling.
This is so heavy.
There's no way I'm going to do 100. I've only done about 3.
Okay.
Just like when I'm walking up the hill, I'm like, oh my God, this is so hard. I look next to me, and there's a woman who's half my size, half my body weight, and she's got a child on her back, and she's probably 20 years older than me, and she's like rushing past me.
After just an hour, boss Sully is concerned that the mine is slowing.
The ladies are complaining that the boys that are taking load to them, they are not hurrying.
Not doing it fast enough.
Yeah. You white people are the forces.
Right, okay.
You forces, yeah.
Yeah, sorry. Just so you know, that I've worked as hard as I can, so
yeah,
I
can see that you have do your best, but
it's not good enough.
Yeah, it's not good enough.
Right, that's fair enough. At the end of the day, if we're not giving them enough mud and stuff, then potentially not processing enough gold, so time's money, so it's fair enough.
If you didn't get enough loot, you lose gold. That's how it is. You lose money. Yeah. We are not joking with our time.
Gold from the mine is regularly sold at the local market. The Brits have just 2 days to find at least £200 worth of the precious metal, or the mine won't make a profit.
More loot.
Got the boss saying, you know, put more. And it's like, I dropped mine up there because it is so heavy. Lucy, move. Lucy. We'll just move then.
No arguing here.
Oh, whatever. Couldn't give a shit.
Everyone's standing there like, what's that? Everyone's standing in front of each other, you can't shout into them, all finding it hard, okay? They're just start shouting. Look, I'm saying to you, you're standing there like a statue. Why, guys, look, just move. You're still away from her now. All she had to say was sorry, that's what I was looking for. She wanted to string it out, talking to me like I'm a child and all that, and you know what, I haven't even got the strength to even go there with her, so we're all feeling the pressure, do you know what I mean, like we're all feeling the pressure, but
the thing is, the last thing we want is everyone shouting at each other. It doesn't help anything. It obviously just lowers morale, gets rid of the team spirit.
2 hours in, the 100-degree heat and repetitive workload is getting to all the Brits.
Oh, my God, this is so heavy.
Including Oscar.
This is honestly the most I've ever sweated in my life. I don't even sweat this much when I go into the sauna.
Come on, man. How do you feel?
Very hot.
Fellow worker Atto has been digging gold for the last 5 years.
I'm amazed that you do this every day. I'm amazed.
Man, not easy.
These women are working so hard. I've never seen women working like this hard ever. These women, I think, are working just as hard as the men here, you know? And they've got babies on their backs.
The local women regularly carry 160 headpans a day, but so far Siobhan has carried just 6. Her attitude and slow rate hasn't gone unnoticed by Atto.
I'm walking as fast as I can.
Just
put your thing down and let me ask you one question. What do you do in your hometown?
I stand with a clipboard and I write things down and I talk to people. But if I can't breathe...
I know, but you know what?
I'm not going back to Britain in a body bag, so I'm trying my best. You're acting like I've walked off. I'm still here. I'm still trying.
Yeah, you are trying, but I need more strength from you. So I thought you were the strongest among the girls. And if you look at the age, she's the oldest. So I was expecting more things from her. Yeah. My expectation from her was so high. But all of a sudden, you down. I was so disappointed.
11 a.m. The heat and the pressure is still rising.
I can't even get my breath.
Feel my shoulders being completely crushed.
If Siobhan is to hit her target of 100 headpans, she needs to pick up the pace.
Oh, how do you feel now?
I can't talk. I haven't got the breath to talk. Sorry.
Yeah, you can sit.
But suddenly, it's all too much.
Actually, don't even feel hot. Oh, God.
Siobhan has had a panic attack. Essentially, I think it's the heat. Just doesn't seem to be coping.
The medic, on hand for the Brits in this extreme environment, has to step in.
Something's sitting on my chest.
Around your tongue, fellas. You close your mouth, arms. Might need to hold it.
Well, you're going nowhere.
It's not going back in there. Normal body temperature is about 36.9 degrees. She's now at 38.2. So I'll pull her off for now and then see how she is in a little while. Keep her cool, get the water going in her, see if we can cool down a bit.
It's just relentless. You're just going up and down and up and down. Yeah, I can't even... I feel like my heart is actually going to jump out of my chest. They've had years of training. This is our first day, and literally they're expecting us to do 100. I know the women do 160, but even 10 is a push. Blimey, like, I'm trying my hardest, but literally I feel like I'm going to die.
In Britain, 26-year-old Siobhan is no stranger to hard graft.
I've been working full-time from the age of about 16 and a half, 17. At the moment, I'm doing part-time studying to be a trained surveyor. You know, I always wanted to have a career that I could do anywhere in the world, and people always need surveyors. You need to survey, well, not everywhere, but majority of places, so I'd always be employed.
Siobhan and her sister were raised by their mum in South London.
I didn't have a dad, but my mum was everything. Mum, dad, granddad, uncles. My mum was everything in one person.
She believes in working hard to get what she wants.
I think I've got strong work ethics and motivation because of my mum. I always want to do the best at whatever it is I'm doing. You know, I don't want to go in half-hearted. I don't want to do it for the sake of doing it. I have to like the environment that I'm in.
You miss your child.
She will win, but she's going to... Whatever is there to be done, Siobhan will do it. And whinge before, whinge after, but she will work in the middle of it.
I think I'm quite a strong person, you know, in my life, but I want to see how strong am I. You know, am I just strong with situations I let myself be put in, or am I genuinely a person that can thrive in any environment? So this is what this experience is about for me. It's about showing, all right, Siobhan, you're strong, but are you as strong as you think you are?
Back at the mine, Siobhan is recovering, but gold is losing its appeal.
It feels like I've been here for 3 days, and I know it's only been a couple hours, but... Literally, it could never be expensive enough for you to pay to feel how hard this is. It's like they treat people like they're machines.
Soon, she's not the only one having to take a break. 4 hours in, all the Brits have ground to a halt.
I can't believe these people do this every day. It's crazy. This is just mad work.
No. 26-year-old Amma has worked with the 15 other women at the mine for the last 3 years.
How do you guys keep going and in the hot weather? How do you keep on pushing and reaching your targets here?
Brent, so you need to make a yard. It's in your brim choir, Tambiano, or say your back, and your side, and your scum weight better than it.
Do some of the money that you win, is that going to go on education for your children?
But it was kind of there, and so, like I said, and one, my mom, they told me I am more than I did.
So, does that mean that your children will probably end up working in the mines as well when they grow up? It is literally a case of them growing up here, isn't it?
Literally, like, yeah, but it's quite disheartening to know that it literally looks like this is where they will grow up and this is where they will basically work.
That's literally what the community lives for, isn't it?
Yeah.
This is the only work, it's the only source of income, it's the only means of survival, which is something that we're so lucky to not have to do, you know, if we want to do something worth our lives. Anything's pretty much possible.
Rest over, all the Brits are working again.
That was my 59th.
But they've less than 2 hours to hit their combined target of 400 headpans.
If the other girls, like, don't do as many as they're supposed to, then we're going to end up in a bit of a pickle. Got up to 186, and we're supposed to be on 400. So we've got another 214 to go. Do any of you guys want to, like, start doing a bit of lifting? Oscar, George?
Sure.
Yeah?
OK, nice and easy, hey? It's my first go.
Be better quick. 72.
Genuinely, I'm about to collapse.
It's a last desperate push. But as hard as the Brits have tried, they've run out of energy and time.
You know, no luxury can be worth this. This is pathetic. It's not anything that we need to survive. Jewelry is a choice, it's a luxury. And you know what? I've been here a day and I feel like I'm gonna die. So it's not worth it. It's blatantly not worth it.
Stop work. We have closed. I've given you enough time. You haven't do as we expected.
After 7 hours of back-breaking work, the Brits failed to reach their target. They're nearly 100 short. If there is to be enough gold to sell, they'll have to work even harder tomorrow.
You must be here early in the morning.
Are we doing this
again?
We have
to start early.
Again?
Yeah.
We're doing this again tomorrow.
The same job?
Yeah.
No!
Are we going home now, Emmanuel?
Yeah.
Cool.
All the Brits are staying with local families, four of them with fellow miner Emmanuel.
My families are in the house waiting for you.
Are they? How many of them?
Oh, we are about 18.
18 of you? Waiting for us in the house?
Yeah.
No!
Like many of the men and women working at the mine, Emmanuel's basic living wage of around £4 a day doesn't just support him.
This is uncle.
Your uncle? Hello. Uncle. Nice to meet you, Alex.
Pleased to meet you. This is Samson Kofi.
Kofi? Yeah. Hi.
This is my elder sister. Her name is Gladys.
Hi, Gladys. I'm George. Yeah.
The young guys here, they are all my niece and nephews.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. That,
hey, let's not forget, this is my mother.
Oh.
Hello there. Yeah.
Hello, George.
My mother's name is Mary.
Mary.
Yeah.
Hello, Mary.
They are all staying here together.
Emmanuel's extended family has been dependent on him since his father's death 2 years ago.
So I'm the one taking care as a father to my family. So all the 17 depend on me.
Really?
I'm the one working. Then what I earn from the work, then I give to those who are learning trade, those who are in the school, a lot of them. So I have a lot of responsibilities. So that's how Ghanaians traditional. So if you are a guy, when you're grown up, you are the one going to take care of the family. It's your responsibility.
Well, thanks for being so generous as to have us four on top of your 17.
Oh, don't worry yourself. Don't worry yourself.
Like 21, just in case you didn't have enough on your plate.
Oh.
It's just unbelievable when you look behind.
That is amazing.
You support all of these people on your own. I mean, I can't even begin to imagine what that must be like, that kind of responsibility.
It's in Ghana here. I have no other alternatives. That's part of life. It's part of life.
In our lives, well, my life personally, I'm just thinking of number one, that's me. And he's supporting 17 other people as well and thinking about everyone else's futures before his own. So selfless. And at such a young age, working so hard. It's amazing.
Whenever I'm thinking about my life, it's my life. Yeah. I don't think of a we like that. Automatically, I'm not thinking we. I'm not thinking, how can I make my sister's life the best? How can I make mum's life the best? Despite the difficulty of their position, they're not being selfish. They're being exactly the opposite. And constantly thinking about the future of the family. It's just, that is the ultimate sacrifice. Yeah. I'm sorry for crying. Just that my father, he left when I was very young and he never cared, not about me or any of my sisters. Whereas someone like you, who at the age of 25 is taking on the responsibility, not running away, like willingly taking on responsibility for 17 people who aren't even your children. And it's just, it really, you know, it makes me quite emotional.
Alexandria grew up with her mum and sisters. She's not had regular contact with her dad since she was a small child.
It's always been us girls, really. My parents divorced just before I was born.
I feel sorry that they haven't been able to enjoy having a two-parent family. But, you know, that can happen with a lot of families.
I've got my sisters, I've got my mum, I've got my friends, and essentially I've got me, so I've never really felt like I needed anything more than that.
This 20-year-old law student has always been known for her independence.
From a very young age, I was very certain about my views on this, my views on that. I was always very confident.
Never afraid to compete, Alexandria has always been top of the class.
I was head girl. I also became student rep for the Law Society. I was president of the Debater Society.
I just don't understand how it can be accepted, because, frankly, the point is...
I think already at this age, at 20, she's starting out very much on a pathway that really is of her own making.
Back in Ghana, the group have all been affected by how Emmanuel puts his family first.
It sort of made me think a lot about my relationship with my father, which I never ever thought that I would do during this trip, and I certainly don't take lightly or talk about easily. How selfish was he, you know, to have walked away from his children? He's not around, and you see Emmanuel, he's there for like, what, like 17 people, and to think that, like, I have someone personally in my life who walked away. And what kind of culture and society do we have that makes people like you and makes that okay to do? You know, that upsets me, it massively upsets me.
I've never met anyone like him, and he's 25 years old. I'm 20, and I just goon about acting like an idiot. My dad's been working hard for years to provide for me so that I can have an education, so that, say, there's little things that I need, he can provide that for me, and my mum's there emotionally. It makes me want to go back and show them how much I appreciate everything they've done for me. And, you just want to go back and become a better person.
It's time to wake up.
Wake up now.
It's a 5:30 start for the Brits, and yesterday's work is taking its toll.
A little bit achy, actually. My little alarms aren't used to the work that I done yesterday.
At Emmanuel's, with 17 people to look after, the hard work begins at home.
Days don't start at 9 a.m. here, they start at 6 a.m. It's just the way of life.
Essentially about the same distance I'd have to go to the supermarket to get bottled water, because I don't drink tap water.
You just got to get on with it like the rest of the locals have been doing for years, so no complaining, just got to go and do the work.
After missing their targets at the mine yesterday, the Brits can't fail today. If they do, mine boss Sully won't have enough gold to sell later.
You'll be taking what you have did yesterday and today's gold to the market. Yeah.
But to be sold.
So, man. Yeah. Work really hard today, guys, and we get to take loads and loads of gold to the market.
Yeah, I want you to close with my local people. So around one, everybody must finish the target, which is 100.
The target is even tougher than yesterday. The girls must carry 100 headpans, but in almost half the time.
It feels like 2 seconds since we were last doing this. It feels like it was only like an hour ago since I last had this hat on. And it makes me think, like, these women do this day in and day out. It doesn't really feel like a lie.
It's so much hotter today than it was yesterday. I mean, it's not even 9 o'clock yet, and I'm already sweating from just sitting in the shade. Worked out, pretty much averages out about 1 every 2 minutes that we've got to do on today's targets. And that's in 4 hours.
Today, the mine's machine will be separating the gold from the mud. It too will have to work flat out. As loaders, George and James must ensure it does.
The reality is, like, in each shovel, there could be a bit of gold, and then think about how many shovels we put in the machine, the accumulation of gold. It is, when you actually think about it, which I haven't had the time to, it is quite crazy to think the amount of money that's in there.
Today I'm really struggling. I'm not saying it's not any more than anybody else, but literally, my legs feel like jelly.
The girls should be keeping pace with the locals, but they've only delivered 40 headpans in the first hour.
I'm trying, but it's not good enough.
It's even hotter than yesterday. Soon Siobhan is in trouble again. But this time, rather than conflict, there is comfort.
You're fine, okay? It's one day. You're gonna get through the day. These guys go day in, day out, and you just gotta, you know, keep going. And the thing is, you can go away from here, and that's what's even the saddest thing is the fact that
I'm trying my best, but I've got nothing else to give you.
Shit, we are all finding this, you know, the hardest thing that anyone here has ever done. You just gotta put a smile on your face, keep going, you know, keep strong, and just think, we're doing it as a group, you know, it's a group effort all the time.
I'm learning maybe emotionally I'm not as strong as I may think I am. I barely cried. The only time I cried was when my nan died. And literally, this has actually pushed me to tears. To put the fact that I'm sitting here crying goes to show that this is how deep this is feeling for me. I am part of that industry. We all are. We've been feeding it. And these people are working triply hard. The demand is on them to keep producing. No one could justify this to me. I'm disgusted.
Having heard how vital the mine's wages are for local families, the Brits are more determined than ever to finish.
I've been working at this home because we're a guy who supports 17 of his family members. If you really want to begin, you feel sorry for them. They're trying to understand what it's like. And to do that, you've got to work your arse off all day long.
Apart from anything else, I mean, if I was to back out there now, I'm sure that it's happened to some of the people who are working here. You know, they don't have the option to go home. We've got a target to hit. We've got to work as a team. I want to try and pull my weight.
The deadline is looming. Even Siobhan is back on her feet.
That's your last one. Before time. Thank you very much. Work done. Sam, you are finished. Work done. You have tried your best.
Hold on, have I got my head? Oh.
Yes, Siobhan. That's your last one.
As the clock runs down, all of the Brits hit their target.
The last one. High five, yeah. Thank you, darling, thank you.
For the last 4 hours, the Brits and 28 locals repeatedly shoveled, loaded and carried the gold-rich earth. Now they're about to find out how much of the precious metal their back-breaking work has produced.
That's how we do it.
Oh my God.
they have turned to white because of the mercury.
They sift through it all now, and that's all it's come to.
20 odd people grafting for that end product.
People have a big gold chain on their neck. That's, you know, that's probably like 2 months' work.
Yeah.
It seems so insignificant compared to what goes into it.
The next stage is to burn off the impurities. The gold from both days' work is now ready to be valued.
Wow.
Whoa, that's shiny now. Whoa.
It is quite pretty and things there now, yeah, and, you know, you have to recognise it as being gold.
When we were mining for it, I thought that's what it would be like when we found it. I actually, that's how stupid I am, I actually thought you'd find that in the soil and be like, oh, found some gold.
No, I didn't, I thought it would be a lot bigger than that. I thought it would be like, that'd be like the smallest bit that you'd find.
Yeah. Should we go see how much it... how much it weighs and adds up to?
You say the price is how much?
It's 3.6.
Sully is anxious for a good price.
It is called 22.17.
Yeah.
22 carats.
The so last... pure gold is 24 carats.
Yeah,
that's the highest.
Yeah, that's the highest.
So
22
is pretty damn pure. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you very much. 427 Ghana cedis.
427?
Yeah.
So that's £213.50.
Could you calculate how much money you'll actually get personally from that after, you know, taking off all your overheads?
That's a 21 Ghana.
So after all that, you've made 21 Ghana CDs profit after 2 days?
Yeah.
£10.50?
Yeah.
The money is divided amongst 28 workers. Whilst the women get about £3 a day and the men £4, boss and owner Sully is only making just over £1 more.
Where is the profit really being made? Because Sully clearly isn't making any profit from this. After you bought the gold today, where does the gold go to and how much do you sell it on for?
Every Wednesday,
how much do the white people buy it off you for?
5 Ghana cedis difference.
How much?
5 Ghana cedis difference.
So £2.50 on top of that, really, is his profit.
Made into a ring and sold abroad, the same gold would fetch about double the price, around £400.
It's sort of ironic, really, when you have millions of pounds underneath you, yet they're living in mud huts and still, you know, going to the toilet in holes in the ground.
The money that we're spending on gold in the UK should be finding its way back here somehow, and it's trickling through at the point there's hardly anything here.
Without the mine, the locals would be worse off. But the Brits want to find out what other prospects there are for miners and their families.
Now you can sit down. Yeah, sit down.
Cheers, dude.
24-year-old Atto has been working in the gold mines for the last 5 years.
Our lives are cut off. The only life that I enjoy is about reading. I read everything. I've got that ambition of reading to become a journalist.
It is your books you...
These are the little books that I've read. They are school books. Take my time to read every word to get the meaning.
Do you think you'll ever be able to go back to school, to go to university?
I've got to pay huge money at the university. And look at me. I work from hand to mouth. So what is the possibility of me getting that money to go and pay? But I tell you, man, if I have a quarter of the opportunity that most of you have got, I would have blown heavens.
I know.
I would have blown heavens.
It's just making me think. I've come from the UK, from a privileged background, and I didn't want to go to school. I wanted to go out there and work and make money. You know, I just thought I knew better. And I feel disgusted that I was that flippant with something that is a blessing.
You said earlier that you didn't enjoy your life.
That's quite tough to hear. I promise you, I see more happy faces here than I do in the UK. I promise you that. I've had a privileged upbringing, and I haven't felt as good as sometimes just being on my own and having nothing.
But also, how can you say something you can't even afford to buy books?
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying.
No, you're not. You're talking to the wrong person. You want to say that you talk to a consumer.
Remember that it's not about what you have that brings enjoyment. It's how you're going about it, because it's the process.
Apparently not.
It is
apparently not being able to read. Apparently not having.
So you're shouting. Don't shout at me like that.
She's talking to you, man.
Yeah, but she's shouting at me like that. Mm. I'm not shouting. It upsets me when enjoyment is placed on materialistic things.
He's not talking about, when he was giving examples, he's talking about how it is in the Western world. He's not saying that's what makes people happy.
For me, I think education is the absolute. If I have education, I can go wherever I want to go. I can do whatever I want to do.
The fact that nobody is lending you a voice, or nobody's here to back you up or to help you, it's just, you know, it's horrible.
He's so clever, and he could achieve so much, and he could have a completely different life, and he's so aware of the situation he's in, he's so aware of the fact that he is at the bottom of the pile in many ways, and that he so is trapped in his life, and yet there is nothing he can do about it, absolutely nothing.
We know a little bit about two people's lives here. Think about all the other thousands of people in this area and their stories, and how sickening it is the fact that they can't do what they want, which we can do.
The simplest of things, like we can just go to the library and they give you a library card, you can just go and get books. To him would be like, he's won the lottery, literally that would be like his dream. It's crazy.
Arto said, if I had quarter of the opportunities you had, I would smash the heavens. Smash the heavens.
Reach for the sky.
Smash the heavens, reach for the sky, have success. What the fuck is that? Do you know what I mean? I'd love to put some pen and paper to smash the heavens. What is it?
Quite easy to understand, man. If he had a quarter of opportunity, he'll get an education and some and be successful in his own mind.
What Atto was saying about the luxuries that we have in England, and out here, luxury for him would be an education. And people look past that because everyone in the UK is offered a free education from primary school to secondary school. I'm thinking if I went back to Brighton in my house and was to switch lives and he was to be there, he'll be grabbing all the opportunities and making the most of it. It does make me appreciate the things like education. It makes you want to work harder, because otherwise it's just a waste.
Today, the Brits are leaving the gold mining community. They've all been affected by the time they've spent with Atto and Emmanuel.
I'd like to say thank you, Emmanuel, for opening up your home to us. I'd personally like to give you a small gift from myself. This is my favourite gold pendant, and I'd like to give you that to remember you by, etc., and to look after that, because that's something important to me, and I'd like for you to have that.
I thank you very much for giving me such a great honour.
That's my guy.
G-man.
I did put a lot of emphasis on my material things, and, you know, this situation here has highlighted that, you know, maybe I need to get some priorities in order.
Hi.
The Brits are travelling 175 miles east to Ghana's capital, Accra. Having spent the last few days learning where much of our gold comes from, they're about to discover that Ghana is also where many of our high-tech goods end up.
Oh, it stinks.
Dumped, with dramatic consequences for some of the country's poorest children.
It
smells like shit.
Oh my god, I'm so not hanging around here without a mask on. That stuff can be toxic.
This is the Agbabloshi waste site. Stretching for over a mile, it's one of the biggest dumps in Ghana. But it's not normal household rubbish here. Each month, hundreds of tons of Western electronic waste arrives. No official organizations run the dump, but local journalist Mike Annan has agreed to be the group's guide.
This is where majority of the computers and television sets that you use in the UK end up. There is some toxic smoke, and you just have to be careful. You stay away, some meters away. You might be inhaling something that you don't want to inhale.
Hey, don't put that away! Hey!
It's in hostile, people are like, move, move, why are you here? Move, go away. It's just weird, man.
It's just revolting, everything. It's like walking through the apocalypse. It's horrible. Really horrible. And there's kids just sat playing with rubbish.
What is really going on here? Like, what is this?
Like, amazing. Corner us off and just kill us.
Westminster College.
Oh, you've already noticed something.
Westminster College.
Yeah.
Oh my
so.
God,
yeah. So that's College. From the Westminster College.
Oh my God.
You know. Yeah. So what would something used by the Westminster College be doing here?
There's one here from University of Surrey, which is near us, isn't it?
Wandsworth, property of Wandsworth Borough Council.
Wandsworth Borough. Just half an hour from our work. You know what I mean? I think it's disgusting.
What's me?
I'm basically just saying.
West Yorkshire Police.
Despite apparently responsibly recycling, Western goods can end up here without an organisation's knowledge.
What's going on here? You've got colleges. What's that? West Yorkshire Police.
The companies named on these computers were unaware their items would be dumped rather than recycled.
This is toxic waste. Mm-hmm. And they are here making people sick.
I'm disgusted. Like, I actually feel like I want to turn and walk out.
Laws forbid broken, unusable electronics known as e-waste from being sent to the developing world for recycling. However, some unscrupulous dealers have found a loophole in the system and broken computers are still finding their way to Africa. Companies are led to believe their computers will be reused, but actually many of them are eventually dumped in places like Ghana.
A lot of these things are labelled as second-hand reusable items, but the reality is that they are junk, they don't function, they are end-of-life computers, end-of-life television sets. These things should be checked in the countries of origin.
Yeah.
You know, each time the e-waste is dumped here, the computers and television sets, they are dismantled by children, some as young as 5 years of age.
Our ever-growing need to constantly upgrade means dumps like this are on the increase across Africa.
What's your name?
Ali.
Attracting thousands of young boys like Ali.
What are you doing?
I'm breaking it.
You're breaking it?
Yes, I'm going to sell it.
You're going to sell it?
Yes.
So which are the bits that you want?
Huh?
Are these the bits that you're going to sell?
Yes.
To look at it, it's just absolutely mad, because I mean, that could have come from a computer in my house for all I know.
There's money here to be found, and there's a reason that businesses don't come here and do it themselves. It's dangerous.
Ali is one of around 400 children who scavenge at the site every day.
So this bit around here is what you want,
this
yeah?
Is the,
and yeah, stuff inside as well. Yes. Smash this bit here.
Here.
Squash it like that.
I did too, yes.
Why'd you do that? Yeah. To fit it in your bag? Ah, yeah. I see. So one computer monitor, TV monitor, this is what they get out of it. And how much do you guys reckon you'll get for this?
£1,050.
Oh, so you get 10 pesos for this? Okay, so these guys get 10 pesos, which is equivalent of 5p back at home.
Ali and the boys build fires from anything they can find.
You know when you're starting the flame, let it stand round this side so it doesn't go in your face.
The fires are used to burn off plastic, so valuable copper wires can be collected. Toxic and potentially cancer-forming chemicals are constantly pumped into the air. 12-year-old Charles has been scavenging for the last 7 years.
Your voice is very husky. You have, you have. Is that from
because
being here?
Of the fire.
From the smoke.
Yes. 1 month, you know. We me boa blood, moja.
Blood.
Yes.
So you've had a cough for some time, and then in the last month when you are cough, you get quite a lot of blood come out as well.
Where do you sleep?
Yeah. I don't have
a house.
Bed sheets.
Don't have bed sheets. Yes. Do you have shelter?
No.
So you're out in the sky? Yes. Under the sky?
Yes. Yeah, I can sleep here. Tomorrow I'll get out.
So you just sleep in the open every night?
Everywhere.
What do you want in the future? What do you want to be? What do you want to do with your life?
I want to go to school.
You want to go back to school?
Yes.
Disgusting.
So this is the copper that they've been able to salvage.
So you sell that now?
Yes.
Okay, let's go and sell it then.
At the end of every day, Charles teams up with the other boys to sell any metal they found.
So that's 1 kilogram. Okay, so how much money would these guys get for 1 kilogram?
2.5.
2 cedis, 50 pesos. So that's £1.25 these guys are getting for this metal that we burnt this morning. Can you get water with that?
Yes.
You can get water with that. Can you get any food?
No.
Only water.
Only water. It's hard, man.
Global scrap prices are soaring. Yet split between three, Charles and his friends have earned about 40 pence each. It's double what they could have earned selling water, but it might be costing them their lives.
Did you miss a lot of school?
Yes.
To get money?
Yes.
What does he do with the computers when you get here, when they get here?
We share them. But the money we earn is not enough for us.
Has anyone told you that it's dangerous to work on this?
Is
there nothing else that you could do? Is there no other jobs that you could do? Well, then why don't you choose to do that when it's so much less dangerous than this here?
I know my young cousin said, when so much family or her, my young girl and friend, treasure in India, now my young girl is over in Kosqua.
The reason why Kome works here instead of working in water is because there's more money to be made here.
5 years ago, a car accident left Kwame needing a catheter. He has to earn enough for both his family and his hospital bills.
He comes to work in this shit every single day. There's maggots, there's flies, there's crap everywhere, there's cut glass. Not only does he risk cutting himself, but he also risks affecting his catheter, everything getting infected. He goes to the hospital every 3 weeks to get changed, and they tell him, don't work here, don't come back here, and he always does, because he needs the money.
That's it. What do you mean, Joshua?
It's horrible.
I mean, look at him, and to use waste to mop up a cut. Look at those. Children's hands. You know, a cut and... You know, they're workers' hands, they're not children's hands. He's risking his own life every single day. It's just not right. And I don't even know who to feel angry at. Is it the parents for letting them come on here, or is it us in the West for feeling like as if we can just let our stuff turn up here? It shouldn't be happening. We shouldn't let this happen. And yet it is. And for what? So that we don't have to, so that we in the West don't have to deal with our own shit. Well, guess what? The shit goes somewhere, and it ends up on the doorstep of children. So who's proud now?
Having been unable to find any charities solely dedicated to working with the dump kids, the Brits turn to their own doctor for advice.
We've actually got a medic here with us on this trip, so I'd like to speak to him and see what we can do for these children.
If it's not an option to move out of there, but basically look at any industry in the UK, you'd be, you know, covered from head to toe with like personal protection equipment. So simply wearing like a good set of shoes or boots that they can take off at the end of the working day, gloves, and maybe like a gas mask with like a carbon filter or something to like, you know, limit the amount of toxins that they're actually breathing in the working day, you know?
I think our first step is to go shopping, go buy some kind of protective gear for these kids to wear, go back to the dump and hand it out, and then maybe speak to a few parents to make sure that these kids, if they're going to be hanging out here much longer, they should be wearing this safety stuff, because, you know, they're going to be just so unhealthy.
Unfortunately, I don't know whether or not this will make any difference to them.
I know, but at least we can go away and say, you know, we did something, we put it out there to try and make that difference, then we can go away and feel a bit, you know, more peace of mind that we've actually tried, we've actually, you know, done something to try.
Aware it's only a small gesture, Lucy is meeting with Charles again.
Okay, and you told me about your cough. It's really worrying. If I had that back in the UK, I'd be very worried, you know. It's quite a serious symptom to have. If you're always going to be here, I want you to wear something that's going to protect you from being here. So if I give you some stuff to wear, will you promise you wear it?
Yes, I'll be legging it.
Yeah, you promise?
Yes.
Okay. I've got you some new shoes. I've got you a new top to wear. If you go anywhere near the fire, I want you to wear this. Okay? And you wear this until you earn enough money to move away from, as far away from here as possible, okay?
Yes.
You promise?
Yes.
You want to try the mask on?
Okay.
Okay. You go. That's all yours now, and you wear it, okay?
Thank you.
As long as he wears the shoes and he's not standing in bare feet on that broken glass, then that's okay. And I want him to wear the mask if he goes near the fire, but I can't really... To be honest, I can't imagine him whipping it out when he's with his friends and putting it on when he's near the fire. But, you know, I hope he does, and if he does, it'll show that he's worried about his health.
Alexandria wants to understand more about why Kwame doesn't do a safer job like selling water. She's going to speak to his mother.
Kwame, who's this? Your what? Your mother. Hello. What's your name?
Sarah Pupia.
Sarah Pupia.
Yes.
Alex, nice to meet you. Kwame, can you show me your bedroom? Here? What, in here?
No.
On the veranda.
On the veranda. Oh. So this 2 meters of veranda is your home? Whoa. How come you're living here?
Actually, didn't have
any savings because Kwame's got a catheter and is really ill. They had to spend all of the money on getting him to hospital and treating him. So essentially, with no savings and no home to live, they've been forced to move in onto a veranda. Do you understand that the toxics he's touching and being near the fire, they cause cancer and they will eventually kill him? How are you going to pay for Kwame's surgery? You know, before I came here, I felt angry at her and she was responsible because how could she let her son go and work on the dump site? But having spoken to her now, I mean, she's basically saying to me that she understands everything. Can you imagine as a mother having to watch your child leave every single day to go and work on a dump site when you know full well that he is putting himself at high risk of so many diseases and that in the long term he's going to die of his work? I brought a little something along. I know it's not a lot, but I just hope that it would help Kwame, you know, and just limit the damage of what he's doing. Listen, I know it's not very cool, and it's not very hip, and you're probably not going to like it, but I got your mask. I bought you gloves. So you got to keep these. Don't lose them. A T-shirt, a new one. And I got you some shoes, okay? And you have to wear them. There we go. I just asked the mum if she'd get Kwame to wear it, and she told me that she would. So I'm quite positive about that. And if he doesn't wear it, then you know what, at least I've made a gesture. And he'll keep the shoes, I'm sure, and the gloves. So, you know, I mean, it's nothing, but it's something, so.
When reusable electronics first started arriving, Ghanaians welcomed them as they helped close the digital gap between the developing world and the West. But now, as numbers of broken and unusable items keep growing, so do dump sites like Agba Bloshi.
For me, the fact that the British are on some level contributing to that, it embarrasses us and it makes me feel sick to my stomach.
Do they think recycling is children burning harmful plastics in order to sell copper to eat is recycling? They couldn't be more wrong.
So many people shouldn't be allowing this, but yet it is occurring and it's disgusting.
And you know what? This is just the tip of the iceberg. There's so many of these dump sites all over the place, and the more we upgrade, the more we buy, the more we consume, it's not going to go away. It's going to pile up. It's going to be more crap, and there's going to be more children like Kwame working on these dump sites so that they can deal with the shit that we have enjoyed.
Next time, the Brits face a very different challenge in the cutting-edge electronics factories of Southeast Asia.
This is the fiddliest thing I've ever done in my life.
As they discover the truth behind our MP3 players.
If you could do this all day, day and day out, what would your brain ever think about?
They will learn about the sacrifices that workers are forced to make.
She's got the weight of about 6 other members of her family on her shoulders.
And the alternatives to life in the factories.
I have to be honest, this for me is very shocking.
And you can see that brand new Blood, Sweat and Luxuries all about MP3 players Tuesday at 9. Some really interesting issues were brought up in the show tonight. We'd love to hear what you think. So get involved in our debate. Just go online to the BBC Three website and click on blog.
Autistic Superstars continues Thursday at 9 on BBC Three.
2 days.